So hi everybody, I would like to thank the organizer and especially Arben for inviting us to present those results, which are preliminary. This is a contribution by many French guys from ISTER Grenoble, BRGM Orléans, University of Toulouse, and EDF in Paris. Just for the background, like many people in the audience, we are trying to predict, estimate earthquake ground motion using physics-based approaches, that is by directly solving numerically the physical processes that cause the ground motion from the source, the propagation, and the site effect. So this is, of course, complementary to empirical data-driven approaches. And the physics-based approach is naturally limited in frequency, sometimes by computational resources, but most of the time now by the lack of information and the uncertainty about the parameters to feed our model in terms of source and especially model. So if we want to increase, push those physics-based prediction to high frequency, there are a few ingredients that we need. First, more geological, geotechnical, geophysical data to build the models. We have to accept also the fact that the description of the medium and also of the source cannot be fully deterministic. It has to account for a stochastic part. This stochastic part has to be physically sound, then implemented in our numerical tools and verified. We also need more computational resources because we are increasing the frequency, but also because of the stochastic part, we need to perform ensemble averages. And also we need more observation with higher spatial resolution for validation. Here, I'm focusing in this on the example of the Grenoble Valley. And as you have seen with the talk of Cécile just previously, we now have the information to produce a model for high frequency simulation. So the target is here is to simulate earthquake ground motion up to frequencies of 5 Hertz. And we are going to implement a part of the model that Cécile presented, which is here on this western part here, the A zone, a small part, 3 km by 1 km. And in this part, we have a two-scale description of the model with a deterministic macro zone description with a clay and gravel zone and some stochastic fluctuation that are superimposed. And the question that we want to raise, of course, is what is the effect of the macro zone and of the fluctuations on Earth ground motion characteristics such as amplitude and duration. So before to do that, I would like just to recall a few things about the accuracy of numerical solution in heterogeneous media. And what we have learned in the last years, when we compare different prediction of earthquake ground motion by different code implementing different numerical methods, is that usually you have always a good agreement on the first arrival, which are mainly body waves. And the level of error can really increase when you look at late arrival from most of the time containing surface waves that are diffracted locally. And those errors, in fact, they depend on the smoothness of the medium. And they are really caused by the fact that there are some small scales in the medium that you cannot represent numerically. This is here an example of a simple case, a layered basin model for which we have an analytic solution. And this is a numerical solution here, which is computed by a code implementing a spectral element method. So whenever your spectral element mesh is able to follow the discontinuities in the model with the element boundaries, you may obtain a very good solution. But if it is not the case, as it is in practice in complicated 3D geometry, you can have some very a loss of accuracy that can be really spectacular, especially for surface waves that see this error here for a long time. It accumulates for a long time, propagation time. And this error here is just simply a consequence that you are trying to represent a step here, a discontinuity, on a local basis of higher order polynomial, but you don't have enough polynomial in your basis. So this fact is true, in fact, for any grid-based method, finite difference, finite element, discontinuous Galertin or spectral element, and any kind of subscale heterogeneity, not only interfaces. Each time you have a small scale that you cannot represent, then you may expect a high level of epistemic error. So the solution to remove this error basically is to filter the small scales by defining some effective media. In fact, you are trying to do like the waves do. The seismic waves, they do make an average of the small scales. And you can refer to here the work by Yann Capdeville in the recent years to see that this average is like results in an effective homogenized medium which is fully anisotropic, and that you may compute in some cases. There are also some simplified effective media that have been proposed in the recent years by, for example, the team by Peter Moxo and Joseph Christek, that contain less parameter like elastic purely or orthorhombic with non-parameter. The good thing for those effective media is that they can be computed in a pre-processing phase. And once you have done this, you decrease the level of error. And for the methods that are based on meshing, then you simplify the meshing because you don't need to follow the interfaces anymore. This is what we have implemented here for the case of Grenoble. And this is implemented in the code, which is named EFISPEC3D, which implements the spectral element method, which is developed by Florent Demartin at BRGM. So you see here a typical mesh that we are using for a target frequency of 5 Hz with a minimum velocity of 250 meters per second. And this mesh basically is composed of some refined area that are formed by using the refinement scheme of the Qubit software. And if you zoom here on the valley, you see that in fact, you don't follow the interface between sediment and bedrock. This is just a zone in which you will implement an homogeneous medium. So it makes the whole procedure much simpler. So here, I'm going to show you some results. So how are the macrozone implemented? Well, it's quite simple. You start from a reference 1D model here, which is a linear model here in shear wave velocity. And you account for macrozone in the top 50 meters here, just by setting a constant velocity for the clay macrozone dominated by clay, so 250 meters per second. And 375 meters per second for the gravel zone. Okay. And I'm going to present here some results along this profile in the western part of the valley where we have implemented the heterogeneous part. I'm looking here at the excitation of the model by a point source, which is a local event. Strike slip mechanism with a source time function, which is such that if you look at the displacement, basically you have a flat displacement spectrum. So no source signature. And I'm looking here you have a cross section here of the profile, which shows that the geometry of the bedrock to sediment, lacustrine sediment interface is quite complicated. And on top, you have those effects of the macro zone with clays here on the left. Southern part and gravel on the right on the topmost. So here you see a seismic section along the profile representing the horizontal ground acceleration east-west component. So what you see here as a function of time, here you see on the valley edges the arrival of the P wave and then on the S wave. And what you see first is that if you look at the S wave, it's quite striking, is that the S wave here is really affected by the geometry of the interface here. So you have some strong focusing and defocusing effect. What you see also here at the transition between clay and gravel, you see that it plays a role. For example, here you see clearly some backscattered surface wave energy that comes back to the clay part. So we wonder, in terms of amplification and lengthening of duration, if this, those macrozones have an effect. So I'm trying here. I'm presenting a view of the amplification in this macrozone model compared to the reference 1D model. So what we are representing here as a function of frequency along the profile is a standard spectral ratio between the result with the macrozone. And the reference without the macrozone. And what you see is that you have basically a higher level of amplitude or amplification in the clay part, in the clay zone, in the soft part, which is expected, and some kind of deamplification in the gravel. The value here, 1.5, okay, more than 50%. What is interesting here to see is that for the clay part, you don't see a 1D resonance effect. If it was the case, you would have at the resonance frequency between the deep sediment and the clay, you would have a resonance with the fundamental frequency around here. So it's more complicated and it's more probably affecting surface waves. On this figure, I'm trying to summarize the effect of amplitude and duration, the effect of the macro zone on the amplitude and on the duration. So we take, let's say, an indicator of amplitude, which is the Arias intensity, which in our case is dominated by frequencies between 3 and 5 hertz. And for the duration, we consider the duration which is measured on the Arias intensity between 5 and 95% of the total intensity. And here, what I'm representing in this duration intensity space, I'm representing all the measure. So in blue for the model that doesn't have the macro zone, and in red, the model that has the macro zones. And what you see is that if you see the symbols here, the circle represents the receivers that are on the clay zone and the triangle on the gravel. So what you see is that when you add the macro zone, you really split in fact the two receivers, the two sets of receivers on gravel and on clays. You split them in this duration intensity diagram. What is also not obvious is that all these models show that duration and intensity are anti-correlated. Okay, and finally, what you see, in fact, the main effect is that the effect of macro zone is to increase the amplitude, the intensity. There is a slight effect of duration, which is not that severe. So now I'm moving to the stochastic part. And before to show you some results, I would like to show you a few open questions. So Cécile showed us that from the field and geophysical and all this information suggests that you have target values for the fluctuation, for example, in shear wave velocities that may reach values of 40%. And some correlation length, which are strongly anisotropic. So it is really challenging. So we have a few questions that I will try to illustrate in the next slide about what is the correct parameterization for this kind of fluctuations? How do we implement those fluctuations in our tools? And how can we check that our implementation is accurate? So I will start with the way to implement the fluctuations. So there are several ways to do that. We have tried at least two. One which is very classically used in crustal studies by people working and studying the coda by the crust. In this case, you just add from the background velocity, you add some fluctuations here, and those fluctuations are supposed to be stationary zero mean, and they are completely described by an autocorrelation function, which is here. This is classically what you do. So you define the amplitude, the curve, and the correlation length, and you follow a given autocorrelation function. The fluctuations, in fact, they are generated in the Fourier domain by specifying a Fourier amplitude spectrum, which is the square root of the power spectral density, and a random phase, and you get your fluctuations. So this the recipe is then, okay, you synthesize the PSD up to a maximum wave number, let's say, and then you low-pass filter those fluctuations, because remember that you don't want to have some small scales that you cannot represent numerically. Next, you compute the fluctuation in the spatial domain with an inverse FFT, and you have to interpolate on your computational grid. There are some clear drawbacks that are really common, not specific to the spectral approach, is that you will never get the total standard deviation, the COV, the 5% in this case, for example. You will never get it, because if you would like to get it, you need to have all the Fourier modes, which you never generate. The second thing, which is related to the naive representation of the fluctuation, is that if you have COV that are too high, then, for example, 20%, you start to generate negative value for the velocity. So we have a big problem here, and we are still we need to solve it. We tested a second generation approach, which is a Karhunen-Love approach, which works directly in the spatial domain. Yeah, and it consists in solving an eigen problem which is built on the covariance function C here. So from the eigenvalues and the eigenmodes, you can in fact generate, expand your fluctuations. And you do that, you do the random part by just using some zero mean Gaussian variables. So there is a clear connection between those eigenvalues and the frequency. In fact, they are completely correlated. And this is what you see on the example here. These are two examples of generation of fluctuation with the Karhunen-Love approach. This is the view in space, and this is the view in Fourier domain. And from the left to the right, you are just increasing the number of eigenvalues or eigenmodes, which in fact is increasing the frequency content. And what you see here is that indeed you are enriching your fluctuation by higher frequencies. And what you see also is that your target power spectral density, in fact, you don't have it exactly. You are oscillating with a random variable around this target PSD. Okay, I would like now just to address quickly how do we verify that the simulation in such random media are correct. So this is one example where we are using here a very simple example of a plane wave propagation in a 2D SH case. We use the spectral approach to generate the fluctuation. We use a von Karman autocorrelation function with classical values for the crust, cov of 5 to 10%. What we are doing is that we are performing on the fly the horizontal average. We are also performing some ensemble average on the realization. And this allows us to form what is called the coherent wave, the coherent part of the wave field. And from the amplitude decay with distance of this coherent wave, we can measure directly the Freeman path and so the scattering quality factor. And this is a comparison here between those measures on the synthetics with theory, the mean field theory, which shows that in fact, indeed, we can trust these simulations. But it's a long, it's quite a long work to do. So now, result with in the 3D model with fluctuations. What we did was to use the Karhunen-Love approach, only fluctuation in shear wave velocity. The curve value that were used so far are limited to 5%. And the correlation length are isotropic, and they go from 50 to 200 meters. They follow an exponential autocorrelation function, and you have 10 realization per random medium. So here I'm showing the effect on the PGA maps, macrozone only and macrozone plus fluctuations. So even if you have some good lenses like me, it's not easy to see some differences. There are some small differences, but basically we don't see a lot of effect. So what about other parameters? I'm showing here the same kind of analysis along the 2D profile in terms of Arias intensity and Arias duration. And what you see is that this is in black, you have the value of the background model, and in color, you have the value measured for the different realization of one random medium, the one with the correlation length 200 meter. And you see that you have some small fluctuation here, 15% on the intensity, 7% on the duration, mainly on the clay zone. You still have this anticorrelation of the two indicators. And you have also a small loss of coherency, but I'm not showing this. So my concluding remark here, we are now really focused on these effects. So why do we have such mild effect of the effect of random fluctuations on the ground motion parameters that we are looking? There are some known already answer that we know we want to dig in. First, the curve value that you are using are too small, but our parameterization doesn't allow to go too high in terms of curve. We did not consider density perturbation. We should add them. This is easy. Two physical value reason now why we don't have a large effect. First, the lapse time, that is the times of residence of the wave that we are considering in this heterogeneous area, is really too small. So even for surface waves. And the second thing is that we are probably in a scattering regime, which is high frequency and probably dominated by forward scattering. So we don't have a lot of coda, we don't have a lot of multipathing. So in our perspective, of course, work on the parameterization of the fluctuation, try to extend the random areas to the whole valley to add some lapse time, work on the anisotropic correlation length implementation, and increase frequency range, probably explore different scattering regime. So as you see, what we have a lot of work ahead. Thank you.